Welcome back to the Remote No Pressure Podcast, Bill.
Well, hello.
It's not like the Remote No Pressure Podcast is a physical place.
No, it's not. It's not like you walk in the door, it's a Remote No Pressure.
It's not like, I guess it's kind of like in the cloud.
Yeah.
So when I say welcome back, I'm not talking about to the physical location.
Welcome to the cloud. Welcome to the state of being that is Remote No Pressure.
Welcome back to the Remote No Pressure. The Remote No Pressure.
Welcome to the Remote No Pressure.
Remote No Pressure.
That's right.
You know, and sometimes, like, I am the family antagonist, the agitator.
Yeah.
Always have been. It's a curse of mine. I can't help it. But I've got a brother-in-law. They've been married, I think, 2 years now. And Scott's cool. He's a really cool guy. But I noticed that when I call it the Facebook or the Instagram, it drives him nuts.
Is he a younger guy?
Yeah, he's younger.
Yeah.
You know, he's
not the Facebook.
Right. Yeah. Like it makes a difference, you know? I'll tag you on the Twitter. I'll tag you. And even on the Twitter, if I say tag you on the Twitter, bro, like that sounds kind of cool. Kind of street per se. Okay. But the Facebook or the Instagram sounds like you don't know what you're talking about.
Yep. Exactly. And that's why people say it, right?
And it drives them nuts. Or I'm going to go to the Walmart. Or the Meijer.
Well, which one are you talking about? You mean the one down the road, that Meijer?
The Meijer.
The Meijer.
There's more than one?
Whoa, mind blown.
You know what I mean?
Actually, like, there are two Frederick Meijers in the country.
Really?
Yeah.
Tell me about the other Frederick Meijer, Bill.
West Coast, I'm told. I've never been to one, but I've had people who've come to our neck of the woods on tours.
Okay.
And say like, oh, you have a Meijer here? You spell it all weird, but it's, you know, theirs are called Frederick Meijer. Completely spelled different. Same concept, though.
Meijer, is that German?
I don't know.
I wonder if the one out in California was like a World War II refugee from the Third Reich or something. That's awful. I'm going to have to edit that out.
We got a lot going on in this
one. We were just on it today,
we're two
though.
2 minutes in and we're already taking a nosedive.
It's already gone too far. No, but so I guess welcome you guys back to
the Remote No Pressure.
The Remote No Pressure in the sky. Remote No Pressure in the sky, in the cloud. So that was another thing. Instead of calling it the cloud, we call it the sky.
Let me download this next podcast from the sky.
You guys are downloading from the sky, especially you, Scott, and you know who I'm talking to. Go ahead and download this from the sky. Don't save it on your phone. I'm going to start saying it from now on. I'm going to tell him, hey, Scott, I only got the 10 gig iPhone this time. Well, why is that? Well, I'm storing everything in the sky now.
Man, that Jeff is so out of touch.
Dude, I guarantee you he would get so angry and would just be cool about it. You know, but inside you can tell. He starts fidgeting with things.
Yep.
You know, like, and he wants to correct me.
Looking at his watch.
Yeah.
Oh.
He wants to correct. You know, and that's, you know, whenever you're going out, I'm just going to give a word of advice, especially to some of our younger folk here.
Yeah.
Because nothing's better than getting advice on Instagram or on podcast.
Yeah, exactly.
From
stuff you can trust.
That's why I hired an 18-year-old life coach a couple years ago.
I know.
No, but in all seriousness, there's no better way to make friends and influence people than to just piss everybody off.
Yep.
If you agitate them, if you get under their skin, they're going to like to be around you.
That's going to be a lifelong relationship.
That's really sowing good seed.
But you know, those are the ones that I remember most from high school.
Yeah?
Yeah. The ones who really pissed me off. And I became friends with a lot of them too.
Really?
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yep.
Well, it's funny because in my family, it was a form of endearment. My grandfather would agitate people.
Yeah.
Until I dated this girl, and her name was Angie, and she was she knew my grandparents. It was their pastor's daughter. And we met in Dallas. We were, you know.
You dated the pastor's daughter?
For a minute.
Whoa.
For a minute.
That what they say about the pastor's daughters.
Oh, I know about pastor's daughters. None of y'all email me either. We already know. We already know. No, you know who you are. You know who you are. You know, this podcast, I'm actually holding the microphone in my hand.
Yeah, same here.
I feel like I'm doing standout. You know who you are. Yes, you do. Don't you go emailing me.
And you're leaning Angie. In towards the screen of the computer.
Like it's the audience. You know.
Like lift they're up. Watching you from the sky.
lifting up my eyebrows like, you know. You know. Getting really serious. You know you're out there, Angie. You know you're out there, the pastor's daughter. No, but my grandfather was always an agitator, you know, and he was a lot older. My dad was born when he was like, my grandfather was in his mid 40s.
Right on.
So my grandfather was really old, and he was just an agitator. I don't know how else to put it. It was funny.
He was that generation.
He was, you know, and so I started dating his pastor's daughter, Angie. She was
his pastor's or your pastor's?
His pastor's daughter.
Oh, okay. The plot thickens.
And so my grandfather, Vester Carl Troutman, VC, as he was known.
VCT,
said he got real serious one day when he found out I was dating Angie. And he said, you guys still together?
Pregnant pause.
And no, she wasn't pregnant.
No.
Oh, pregnant pause. No, I'm just kidding.
No, she wasn't pregnant. No,
oh, pregnant pause. Okay, no. No. No, she was actually a really good girl, but she was like a really good girl, okay?
And when you say it that way, though. And,
so Angie was a good girl, and so it's funny how different the connotation can be. She was a good girl, or she was a good girl. You know,
or if you do air quotes. There were no air quotes for this record.
But. I'm doing it to the computer in the cloud or the sky. Right? See, I can't even get the sky joke right. So my grandfather's talking to me. He goes, hey, are you and Angie still together? And I'm like, nah, we broke up. I broke up with her, you know, because we're just different, very different people. Mm-hmm. She's a great girl. You know, no hard feelings. He goes, you broke up with her? And he's always agitating, you know. And I was like, yeah, I broke up with her. You know, we just didn't really hit it off. I actually said we broke up. And he said, who broke up with who? Now, I've never had a personal conversation with my grandfather. It was always just kind of like joking around with me. And I said, yeah, we broke up. And he goes, did you break up with her? And I was like, well, Pawpaw, that's what we called him. I said, that's kind of an odd question, you know. I said, yeah, I mean, I broke up with her. He goes, yeah, right. Yeah, right. And like, I'm thinking, I'm like waiting for the punchline. You know what I mean? Like, I'm waiting for this, like, oh, I'm just kidding, man. And he's like, I don't know why I'm opening up my heart to this guy here. He goes, he's like, yeah, I don't believe that. She's too good for you.
Whoa.
My own grandfather. I'm like, what kind of voodoo spell did this pastor put my grandfather on that he thinks his family's better than his own family?
Wow.
Oh, Pupple. But I don't know.
God rest his soul. Is God. He dead? I shouldn't even surmise.
Yes, I went to college and like, I'm trying to think. That was in 01. After college. Just like 01, 02. And it wasn't long after that he passed away, you know. But agitation runs. There's a long history. You know, I wish I had a long history of millionaires or billionaires, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. And some people get that.
Yeah.
That's great. But I'm just a long history of agitators and antagonizers.
Yep.
Yep.
Well. Where do we go from here?
Man, it just doesn't get any better than the R&P inside the sky.
Really, really looking, really opening up the hearts here.
We really are. Yeah. We're here. It's like a Dr. Phil episode.
Yeah.
And afterwards, I'm going to give you a thought, and I'm going to give you an 800 number. And if you, too, are dealing with grandfather abuse, you can call in, and we'll talk to you as well. Dr. Phil's hilarious. He was on Joe Rogan. Did you hear that episode?
No, I didn't.
Dude, you should watch it. He swears on there.
Whoa. Did he smoke Dr. pot Phil. Like Elon Musk?
I don't think he did. I don't think he did.
While the camera was rolling.
Mm-hmm. No, but this week, we went out to Rockford Brewery and had an event out there with the Backcountry Hunters and Anglers of Michigan.
That's right.
It was a lot of fun, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. Good guys.
Yeah, they really were. And this week, we're actually talking to someone that we met from there by the name of Taylor Ridderbusch from Trout Unlimited.
Awesome.
So here we are at Backcountry Hunters and Anglers, but we met some people from Trout Unlimited. So like minds come together.
That's
great
right.
time. So we interviewed Taylor about our Asian carp issue, and we've had some jokes on here.
Yeah. But in all seriousness.
Get
out.
Go back to your home. Only like five people that was born like before 85 will get that joke. Go back to your home.
Don't you know where your home is?
You're too good for your home. God, and the thing is, that's not a very funny joke. But yeah, it's still
quotable.
But it's quotable.
It's not that old. It's 25 years old now.
25 years old.
Yeah.
I mean, it's aged well.
It has.
You know, whenever I hear go home, I immediately think, you know, go home.
Or when I think of Bob Barker.
Bob Barker. Yeah. The Price is Wrong.
That's right.
You know, it's great comedy. But anyways, enough about that. We have Taylor Ridderbusch on the horn with us today. He's talking to us about Asian carp and the importance of TU and what they're doing in order to save our Great Lakes. And so welcome to the podcast. Let's light the fire. Today on the Remote No Pressure podcast, I'm very excited to have from Trout Unlimited, Taylor Ridderbusch. Thank you very much for hanging out with us, Taylor.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, yeah. Now, we met at the Backcountry Hunters and Anglers event there in Rockford, Michigan, when we were out there a few weeks ago. And do you work with BHA very much, or are you just mainly Trout Unlimited?
Just mainly TU. So I'm employed by TU, and, you know, obviously I've seen BHA on the come up over the last couple of years. And, you know, as I'm doing some of my work, I've seen some of the stuff that BHA has done. I've worked with some of your staff. And so that's been a pleasure. And I saw that you guys were doing kind of a trout opener thing. And so I thought it'd be a good opportunity to do a little bit of networking and talk about fishing. And it was an awesome event. I'm really happy I made the trip over to Rockford for that.
Yeah, we had a great turnout, and it was cool to meet some people in person too that listen, and maybe we've never met them, you know. So it was really cool to put faces to listeners' names, because sometimes you feel like we're on an island, you know, just kind of doing our thing every week, and it's good to be out there. We had a good turnout too, which was very encouraging.
Yeah, it was great. And I'm a fan of the podcast, and you've had on a couple of people that I really enjoy, you know, following. I think, you know, mostly through Instagram, just because of the way the world is these days. But, you know, people like Kayla Lockhart and Casey Badger and April Vokey, all big fans of them. So I'm really excited to join that on your podcast.
Hey, that's awesome, man. Well, what can you tell us a little bit about what your role is at Trout Unlimited? What do you do there, Taylor?
Yeah, so my official title is the Great Lakes Organizer, and an organizer in the sense of getting our membership organized in terms of some of the major policy issues that the Great Lakes region is facing. And I work with them to get them educated on legislative issues, and then getting them in touch with their legislators and trying to affect some change so that we're, you know, protecting, reconnecting, restoring our cold water fisheries. And so I spent a lot of time, most of my time is spent on federal policy issues. I'm going to start dabbling some more in some of the state issues here in Michigan and in Wisconsin. But that's really a lot of what I do. And you know, it's if you really think about it, there's a lot of instances when you're out on the stream or on your way to the stream where you're interacting with rules and regulations and laws that you might not realize. But it's really important that we do this work to make sure that, you know, we have really great rivers and we have access to those rivers. And so I'm really proud to be working in this realm.
Yeah. And the Great Lakes region is just, it's just a phenomenal place to be as an angler. You know, like you said, we have the great rivers and streams and we have the Great Lakes, and it's a wonderful place. I mean, you're never very far away. I know in Michigan anyways, we're not very far away from water anywhere we are. So it's important to protect those things.
Yeah, it's huge. And I mean, so I grew up in Wisconsin, in northern Wisconsin, up by the UP. I lived in Minnesota for a while. Now I'm over in East Lansing, Michigan. And the resources are just incredible. You know, a lot of times when you think about fly fishing, you think about some of the you know, monster streams out west. But we have some pretty premier opportunities here. You know, just thinking about what we have in Michigan and Wisconsin, and even, you know, some of the other states that, that touch a Great Lake. It's really impressive.
Yeah, and a lot of them, like, a lot of people recognize names like Pier Marquette or the Asaba, but there's a lot of off-the-beaten-path streams that, that a lot of the locals know that that are pretty amazing, you know, that aren't as famous, but they're just as good, if not better, and less pressured, you know?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And, I mean, I even, it's funny, I mentioned this earlier today. I was talking to some people at a conference, and, you know, I'll go to some bigger TU meetings out at our national headquarters, and we'll have guys from Oregon and Washington, you know, Colorado, Montana, and I'll tell them that I grew up in Wisconsin. They're like, oh my goodness, have you fished the Driftless? And I'm like, yeah, I have. And I mean, it's really become a destination for people. And we're really lucky to have that, you know, within driving distance, more or less, which is pretty sweet.
How did you get into the role that you're in? I mean, you're a pretty young guy, and it seems like you have quite a bit of responsibility, you know, with TU. How did you end up in that role?
Yeah, so, you know, I'm really lucky. I really do love the job that I have. And when people ask me, you know, what's your dream job? I tend to say, well, I kind of have it. I figured out at some point that I could get paid to talk about some of the things that I really like, which I grew up hunting and fishing and camping. And for some reason, I was always interested in politics in one way or another. And so I got a degree in political science and ended up getting an internship with Ducks Unlimited out in Washington, D.C., working on the Hill up there, and started working on policy issues. And one thing led to another, and eventually I got in touch with TU, and they said, hey, we need somebody in the Great Lakes that's from around the area and is in love with the Great Lakes and the region and has an understanding of some of the policy issues. Would you be interested? And, you know, I just about fell over because I was like, yeah, that sounds great. Let's do it. So I've been doing that for about 3 years now.
That's pretty amazing. Now, here in the Great Lakes where we're at, a lot of the focus that we've been hearing, and me and Bill have been, we've been talking about building a wall. You know, that's kind of like, hey, let's build a wall, you know, and keep those Asian carp out. You know, we joke about it. We almost joke about it just so people will remember, you know, because build a wall, people either get ticked off or they get really excited. But either way, it's an emotional term, build a wall. But, you know, These Asian carp that we are seeing get closer and closer to the Great Lakes, that could really do a lot of damage to our Great Lakes. You know, what can we do? Can we just build a wall, or what can we do, or what has been proposed to keep those carp out of the Great Lakes?
Yeah, so this is something that's been in the works for the better part of a decade, if not longer. You know, so these Asian carp, silver and bighead carp, were introduced into the U.S. in the 60s. They were brought into Mississippi to clean out catfish ponds. And when the Mississippi River flooded, they filled in those ponds and then sucked those Asian carp back into the Mississippi River with them when the waters receded. And they've been working their way north since then. And knowing that that's been a pending issue, we've been pushing for the government to do something about it to protect the Great Lakes. And right now, the Army Corps of Engineers is working on a proposal to increase barrier protections at the Brandon Road Lock and Dam in Joliet, Illinois. And so what they're trying to do is, there's a lock and dam there, and it seems like that's probably the best chance we have to stop them from reaching the Great Lakes as they move up through the Chicago waterway system. And what they want to do is put in a number of different barriers, different technologies that'll stop carp from moving through. So there are a couple of electric barriers that put an electric current in the water that are a deterrent to fish passing through. So they're looking at adding another electric barrier at Brandon Road. They're also looking at putting in underwater acoustic speakers that play a frequency that mess with the fish's brain that they don't want to pass that point. So they're looking at that. They're also looking at adding what they're calling a bubble curtain. So jets that are shooting bubbles up that are a deterrent for fish, and doing all of that to keep carp, Asian carp, from reaching the Great Lakes.
Do you believe, or what is your personal opinion? Do you believe any of those are more effective than the other, or are they all kind of equally effective?
So the plan is is proposing to do all of those, right? So it's going to have the full array, the most technology that you can possibly put into a lock, more or less. They're looking to do all of them, as well as what they're calling non-structural practices. So that's overfishing carp, monitoring the carp, and making sure that they're trying to beat back that population as much as they can.
Now, why is it that, I mean, we've had invasive species before. I mean, in our rivers, in our streams, you know, why is this one so bad?
Yeah, so Asian carp, when they feed, they feed quite voraciously, and they take out really that bottom level of the food pyramid, and from there you start to wipe out all the other fish populations that are really dependent on that bottom layer of the food pyramid. And what happens is, if there's really some interesting data that they pulled together of pre and post carp impacts on fisheries. And if you look at pre carp, you know, let's say there's 10 to 15 different fish species, post carp that gets cut down to 2 or 3. And when we think about what kind of impact that's going to have in the Great Lakes, you know, that's pretty scary. Granted that, you know, we have incredible, you know, both cold water and warm water fisheries that could be impacted by this. And it's not just the Great Lakes proper. When I talk about this, I try and tell people that, you know, I think nobody's certain how well these carp would survive in the lake proper. But it's the impact that they're going to have on some of the major tributaries that we love to fish on. And it's not only fishing, it's the recreation industry as well. You know, people that love to canoe or kayak or float the river. If you get these Asian carp, these are the carp that come flying out of the water that you've seen YouTube videos of. It's really going to change things.
Yeah, you see these rednecks with like cut off jeans riding down the river in Mississippi, you know, drinking beer and trying to capture these things in a net. And I think I don't want anything like that. Neither the fish nor the crazy rednecks in my rivers and streams. But, you know, it looks like a lot of fun, but it doesn't look like the safest recreational activity. But
dangerous. These are big fish.
Yes, I know. And they grow pretty quick, don't they?
Yeah, they reproduce and grow very quickly. So that's another problem, you know, when you talk about, well, just overfish them, just fish the population down. The problem is they reproduce really quickly, and when you have a population that large, it's just hard to keep up and to find them, especially in a river system. And, you know, if a river system is difficult, imagine trying to track down a population in something the size of Lake Michigan. It'd be really tough to do.
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, we've had issues like I'll fish for salmon in the Great Lakes, and, you know, we have this alewife problem. You know, we'll have a ton of them or not enough, or, you know, and the salmon were planted here in the Great Lakes as well. But this fish is completely different than that kind of thing. I mean, this one is the salmon. I'm sorry if I sound ignorant, because I really am, but like the salmon that did not have the same kind of impact because they don't eat on that lower level of the food chain. Am I right?
Yeah, and I think that's really the difference here, is that when we talk about big head and silver carp, these are fish that are really going to become the dominant, you know, like one of the only species that's left. You know, they're really effective at wiping everybody else out because of the way that they feed. They're filter feeders, so that, you know, they're not chasing down, you know, small little minnows. They're sucking in everything that they can. And that has a huge impact, and it's really one of the bigger issues facing any of the cold water fisheries. You know, we spend a lot of time talking about Bristol Bay and Pebble Mine, and I'm sure all sorts of coverage of that. I think this is just as big of a deal, and it's happening to the largest cold water resource, in North America and the country, arguably the world. And so I, you know, I'm trying to elevate that as much as I can.
You know what, Bill?
What's that?
We need a really cool jingle.
Yeah, we do.
For our sponsors. Sponsors. Like that scoop up there. Yep. Yes. Yes. I mean, like a nice gospel choir.
Mm.
It reminds me of
church.
Church. But what was that movie with Whoopi Goldberg? And she was the
Sister
nun.
Act.
Sister Act, you know?
Yep.
Oh, happy day. Okay, but anyways, we need something to come into these commercials, to these
work
sponsors. We're going to work on that.
I know a guy.
You know a guy?
I know a guy.
We'll have to meet. He plays lead guitar for Jesse and the Rippers and his cousin Joey. And they have a jingle studio in their basement.
His wife's currently going to jail.
His wife, they try to get the twins into school. But anyways, this episode of the Remote No Pressure podcast was brought to you by the wonderful people at Sandhill Coffee. Phil Wingo's a great guy.
Yes, he is.
We drink his coffee.
Yes, we do.
We don't just say that.
No, we don't.
We love his coffee. Yes, we do. So check it out. He's actually has a coupon code for us. If you type in, hold on one sec. He actually is offering our listeners a 20% off.
20% off.
Coupon That's code. Awesome. If you use the word outside 19. Outside 19. It's 20% off your first order. Now, you may be saying, should I try this? I got to pay for some shipping. What is the deal here? You're going to get 20% off.
Boom.
Boom. It's a great time to at least try it.
That it is.
Put in your order at Sandhill Coffee.
Good mold-free coffee.
Mold-free coffee.
Yes.
Sandhillcoffee.com. Also, showing some love to our other sponsor, Deli Fresh Design. Now, I know if you're anything like me, whenever I hear the word Deli Fresh, I honestly think of a nice sandwich with some kind of Jewish meat on it.
Whoa.
Like, what are those things called with the brisket on it?
A barbecue?
No. You know what I'm talking about? It's got... good Lord. But anyways, just a deli fresh. Nothing makes me happier than a deli fresh sandwich.
Gotcha.
That would be the commercial. See what I mean? See, we're working this copy out live on the air. Nothing makes me happier than a deli fresh sandwich. But I tell you know what comes in a close second, Bill?
What's that?
My sling pack from Deli Fresh Designs.
I see what you did there.
You see that? You see, that's good copy. But we got to have it before you come on. But anyways,
I know.
If you go to DeliFreshDesign.com. Now, I swear, you see me every time I fish.
Yep.
I do not fish without my sling pack.
You do not.
I swear by it. It's great.
And you swear while you're wearing it, too.
I swear while I wear it.
Yeah.
You know? But Ross White is offering 20% off.
That's not a bad deal.
That's a good deal. That's
like a running theme right now.
20%, baby. 20% only for our listeners here at the Remote No Pressure podcast. And we know who's listening and who's not. Mm-hmm. Don't think you can just Google these and get these anywhere.
They're still going to try.
Anyways, no, Ross White is offering our listeners 20% off if you type in RNP20 at checkout. Again, RNP, Remote No Pressure, RNP20 at checkout. It'll give you 20% off your entire order.
That is awesome. Wow, that's really big savings.
You know what I would do? Hmm. I would get a $1,000 order going.
You'd save $200 instantly.
That's a $200 savings.
How much is a sling bag?
Like $100.
Yeah, it's like two sling bags.
Okay, buy 8 sling packs, get 2 free.
Whoa. But only with that code.
Only with the code that you get here exclusively, folks. No, but seriously, I mean, it's great. 20% off your entire order, RMP20 at checkout. Thank you very much, Ross. Back to the podcast. And one of the things about like Pebble Mine, it's almost like it's just become a decal at this point on a fishing boat. You know what I mean? Because we've been dealing with it for so long, and I don't want to see the Asian carp conversation kind of lose its luster because it's going on and on, you know, because it's a continual conversation and people are just, oh, okay, Asian carp. But it is a serious issue.
Yeah, and, you know, and it has seen some of that same fatigue. You know, it's something where over the last 10 years, it seems to pop up like 2 years at a time, you know, like, oh man, Asian carp are almost here. They're right at the doorstep. And then right. You don't hear anything for 2 years and then it pops up again. But with the decision we have with the Army Corps of Engineers and their final report going to Congress, this is really no pun intended, a watershed moment, that it's kind of do or die, and we have to get this right on this attempt, because if we don't, we're back to square one.
Right. Yeah. What are you guys doing as an organization? I know that you had talked about some things that you guys are doing in Joliet, Illinois there, but what are you guys doing as an organization trying to limit it? I mean, are you guys putting a lot of money behind it and a lot of money behind the research, or what exactly is Trout Unlimited's role in fighting the Asian carp?
Yeah, so I've spent a lot of time educating our members, you know, traveling down to Chicago and spending time with our Illinois council and our Illinois chapters, talking to them about the issue, saying, you know, this is the time for you guys to get really involved, and we need to make a change here. And so we've spent a lot of time on that. We've also spent time interacting with the Corps. So I've flown out to DC and had meetings with the Army Corps to make sure that they understand the impact that Asian carp could have, you know, both on the fishery and the recreation industry. And then also we're looking forward to working with Congress to make sure that Congress appropriates the funds. So they set aside the money to do this construction project, and then they also have to approve, you know, authorize it and give it the go ahead. So our role is going to be ramping up here. As soon as the Army Corps of Engineers submits their final plan to Congress, working with our congressional delegation, not only here in the Great Lakes states, but working with other congressional delegations in places like Tennessee and Kentucky, where they're already dealing with Asian carp, right? So we need to have an eradication plan for them. But then also making sure that they don't make it to Lake Michigan and throughout the Great Lakes.
So these were brought into Mississippi back in the 60s. Were they actually from Asia then, like from China or something? Or where were they originally?
Yeah. So they were from Asia, and they were brought over because of the way they are filter feeders. They were good for cleaning the algae out of catfish ponds. And without really any kind of serious protection during, you know, major flood events, that's when they got into the Mississippi River system.
Could something like that happen today? Like, can someone bring a random fish in, or are there a lot of regulations now that wouldn't allow that to happen?
Yeah, so there are a lot of regulations that are, you know, around the importation of fish. So I wouldn't say that we're 100% protected from, you know, somebody, a one-off person grabbing a carp and dropping it in Lake Michigan. So, you know, that's always a possibility. That doesn't mean establishment, though. Like, that's not going to create a population per se. But there are a lot of regulations as far as what you can do with imported fish. And each state is regulated a little bit differently. So some states you can have triploid fish, which means they're sterile. They can't reproduce. Diploid are fish that can reproduce. So there's different regulations based on species, if you can have diploid or triploid and what you can stock them in. You know, if you have a private pond, if you can stock them or not. There's a whole array of different regulations that really are different state to state.
Because back in the 60s, I mean, even in the 80s, when I was growing up, we didn't even wear seat belts, you know. There was very little regulation. So I can't imagine what it was like in the 60s. It had to be pretty loose and free, you know. So I don't know if you've listened, but I lean very, very libertarian on everything except for like public land access and this kind of thing. And it's like, I can't seem to fit that anywhere in my libertarian mind on like, and if any of my listeners are listening, feel free to shoot me an email, because I'd love to talk to you about some libertarian ideas on this, but how can we have less regulation? But you know, these things need to be taken care of, you know, with the backcountry hunters and anglers and what their group does, it's like that whole public land access thing, I mean, it's a very unique thing in our country that a lot of other countries don't have. And you have to be extremely rich to be able to access property to go fishing on. And, you know, how can I say as a libertarian that I think the government should just completely pull out of that and just sell it all off. I just, my mind can't quite grasp that one area, you know, where, yeah. And I think a lot of people are that way. I think a lot of people appreciate the Great Lakes and this time as we're coming up on an election year and all the craziness that's going on, it's like, what are those things that unite us? And I think, you know, public access, if you really look into it, and protecting our Great Lakes, I don't know a lot of people who can't get behind that when you look at the facts, you know?
Yeah, and you know, especially when you talk about public access, we were as an organization really involved in trying to get Land and Water Conservation Fund reauthorized. We've been keeping a very close eye on what's going on out west with, you know, places like Bear's Ears and really important public access issues in the west. We've seen, you know, large public land sales in the state of Wisconsin within the last 5 years, you know, 10,000 acres of state land sold off. And we're really lucky. You know, I grew up in northern Wisconsin, 5 miles from the Nicolet National Forest, where you had 800,000 acres of trees and lakes and rivers. And until I moved away from that area, I didn't realize that that was uncommon. And so, you know, I think that having those protected is really important, and especially in a, you know, in some of our outdoor activities like hunting and fishing, that we're seeing a decline in people buying licenses and people getting involved in that. Access is the number one issue as a barrier for people. So, you know, making sure that we protect not only our, you know, our federal lands, but state and county public lands are just as important. And I think it's a, you know, a really cool part of what we do at TU is making sure that people have that access.
Yeah, I know in the state of Michigan, a percentage of our licenses goes toward restoration and toward those things that need to happen, you know. And if you see fewer people with access, fewer people buying those licenses, then that's less money to help regulate crazy people from putting random Asian fish in their ponds, you know? So and you're quite an angler as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I grew up hunting and fishing and camping, and you know, for me, it's really, you know, a time to just kind of get away and hang out and enjoy myself, and I love being outside, and with this job with TU. It gives me an opportunity to maybe get out fishing more than I otherwise would, and get to go to some really cool spots because of it. And I've been lucky enough, you know, in the last couple of years to catch some really awesome fish, particularly steelhead that run up out of the Great Lakes and into our tributaries here in Michigan and Wisconsin. That's been super fun and pretty privileged to be able to do that.
Yeah, we have a great steelhead here in Michigan, and it's a very unique fishery for sure. And it's amazing. What got you into, are you a fly angler in particular, Taylor, or do you do spin fishing or?
Yeah, so I would say I've gotten into fly fishing. I got into it before I was with TU. My parents moved to a house on a lake in northern Wisconsin, and it's a pretty small lake, private lake that, you know, only the people that live there have access to. There's no public landings on it. It's basically why it's private. And it's, you know, it's full of bluegills and largemouth bass. And those are fun to catch on a slip bobber or a crankbait for a while. But I was like, man, this would be sweet to catch these on a fly rod.
Yeah.
So that got me into that kind of in my high school and college years. But yeah, I mean, I grew up spin fishing for muskie and northern and walleye and perch and bluegills, doing that just because we had so many lakes around us. But now with TU, I mean, I get to go to some really awesome areas that have premier trout fishing. So I do probably a lot more fly fishing these days than I do spin fishing.
That's amazing. Yeah, I started I've told the story before, but you know, my wife had a newborn, and my kids would go to bed at like 6-7 o'clock at night, and we had two ponds across the street where I used to, you know, that's, you know, where I basically cut my teeth fishing for bluegill, you know, and fly fishing for bluegill. Man, that's a riot. That's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I mean, you can't go wrong with that. You know, if you have a 2 or a 3 weight and you get a 10 or 11 inch bluegill that's cutting across the water, I mean, it's a great fight. It's fun. And when you can catch one every cast, that's hard to beat.
I was up in northern Michigan a couple weeks ago, and it seems like northern Michigan kind of has a similar landscape as northern Wisconsin. They're kind of on the same, you know, kind of the same lifestyle and whatever. But what did your parents, like, I always wonder, like, what do people do for work? I mean, what did your family do for work up there? What did your parents do? And if you don't mind me asking.
Yeah, no, not at all. So my dad is the editor of the local newspaper from where I grew up. And he's been there, I think close to 35 years now. He's had, you know, he's been at that same paper his entire career.
Wow.
And my mom is a high school English teacher. So I had a little bit of grammar growing up between an editor and an English teacher. But she's had, you know, she's been at the same school for 30 plus years too. Wow. So both my parents have had one job, and which I think is kind of unique. Right. But, you know, having that has been pretty awesome. You know, I through both of them, have been able to get involved in the community up there. And you know, their free time has enabled us to go out and camp and hunt and do all of that. So, yeah, I was definitely very, very lucky growing up.
Speaking of being a newspaper editor, you know, small town newspaper editor for sure. But, you know, these newspapers have changed so much. Over the last 15-20 years, you know, where everything's gone online, there's been this huge evolution. And I don't know, let me ask you this question. How are you guys, what's the most effective way that TU is communicating? I mean, you guys, I know you guys do the Trout Magazine, but what are some other ways and what are some other places that people could find you guys? Because it's not just in a Trout Magazine anymore. You guys do a lot of social or...
Yeah, we do a ton of social. And I will say, you know, in regard to the magazine, I think we've really upped the quality on that. Mm-hmm. So for your listeners that haven't had a chance to take a look at one of those, I would highly suggest trying to get your hands on one, either by joining TU or going to a local meeting and talking to somebody. But we have some awesome content in that magazine, whether it's the photography, the stories, the gear reviews. It's really stepped up to an awesome, you know, fly fishing kind of magazine. But yeah, we do a ton on social. You know, I think our Instagram game has gotten a lot better. You know, whether it's our video content or our photos, we're really active on Twitter, you know, putting out all sorts of blogs and writing that we do for our own website at tu.org. You know, each of our staff. We have 240 staff across the nation. Everybody is more or less tasked with writing a blog or two a year on some of the work that they do. So either our blog on tu.org or, you know, some of the stuff that we put out through our social media channels, you know, the big three between Instagram, Facebook, Twitter is where we're sharing a lot of that content too.
Well, that's really awesome. If people wanted to contact you directly, where would they do that, Taylor?
Yeah, so you can, you know, email me. You can find me on our staff directory at tu.org. You know, you can follow me on Instagram, TRIDD3 on Instagram. Those are probably the best ways to get in contact with me. But, you know, and I'm always willing to try and help people out. You know, I think when we look at some of the recent elections and some of the political climate lately, people are really engaged and they want to get involved, and some people may or may not know how to do that. And I want to be a resource for especially, you know, anglers and outdoorsmen and people that are involved in outdoor recreation. I want to be a resource for them. So I'd be happy to help anybody out that wants to get involved in stuff like this.
Well, that's really great. Well, I really appreciate you taking some time with us, Taylor. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you for listening to another episode of Remote No Pressure Podcast. What'd you think, Bill?
That was pretty awesome.
Pretty awesome. Did you enjoy that?
I did.
We sat here and listened to the whole thing for two hours, multiple times, and dissected it here. No, I thought it was great, and I really appreciate all that Taylor's doing with Trout Unlimited.
Yeah.
And we do have problem. And I think a lot of times, you know, especially growing up in Texas, I didn't understand how wonderful the Great Lakes were or how important they truly are.
Yeah.
The largest body of fresh water in the world.
I know.
Right here. Yep. And we need to protect that.
Absolutely.
And I think sometimes, especially over the years, you know, we've been fighting Asian carp for a long time. And yep. just like Taylor talked about, even like with Pebble Mine, you know, we talk about Pebble Mine and conservation and stuff. It kind of gets, the message gets old, it gets worn down, you know. Mm-hmm. But we got to be diligent. We got to stay in front of people's mind and save the Great Lakes from the Asian carp.
That is correct.
A couple items, please. Go to our whatever platform that you listen to your podcast on.
Yeah.
And leave a review.
That would be awesome. We appreciate reviews.
And let me tell you why. Because John Ahrens, you know who you are. You talked to me this week and said, hey, why are you always talking about getting reviews? And I told you, whenever it's review time, whenever someone's searching for a fly fishing podcast, mm-hmm. the more reviews we have, the better it is.
That's right. The more people it'll draw, it'll... can't talk. Wow. The more people it will draw in.
The more likely it will come up. So be sure to leave us a review. And John Ahrens, one of the things you said was, you don't leave reviews because you're driving when you listen. Take a moment right now.
Pull over.
Pull over.
Throw on your hazards.
Throw on your hazards. And then what I want you to do is I want you to leave a review. And then put your hand out the window and give a big thumbs up. And someone's going to drive by and they too will be listening to the Remote No Pressure podcast. And they will give you a thumbs up. Wherever you are right now, roll down the window and give us a big thumbs up.
What if you're not in your car?
Well, it's between you and your wife.
Whoa.
Or partner.
It's progressive.
We're an open-minded podcast here.
That we are.
Until next time, go fishing.